Now we are moving on to a beautiful work, not just in terms of language, in terms of the dance elements it depicted, the musical elements it depicted. I'm sure most of you or all of you would have heard of Silapadigaram, and I find a lot of lectures on Silapadigaram itself. So I wanted to cover Sangam literature more as far as the music is concerned, basically because I had even A.K. Ramanujam translation. A.K. Ramanujam was a person who translated Sangam poems into English. I find not too much of mention about music in that. Somehow it's disappointing. That is why I wanted to focus, because there are lots and lots of musical elements in this. Not just music, but fun. How these people lived, how it was the part of their life. Okay, Silapadigaram was the first ever epic written in Tamil language. There are five epics in Tamil language: Silapadigaram, Manimegalai, Sivaga Sindamani, Valayapathi, Pundalakesi. Silapadigaram and Manimegalai are related. How they are related is again beyond the scope. Now, Silapadigaram was written by a Jain saint called Ilangovadigal. Jain saint. Okay, his brother was the king, Cheran Singutuvan. He was ruling the Chera kingdom. Silapadigaram, if people are not exposed to it, I will just tell you the story of Anklet, where Kovalan and Kannagi, the main characters, are happily married. Kovalan goes and watches a performance of somebody called Madhavi, and he falls in love with her, and he decides to stay with her. And then due to some dispute, which is again patriarchal and also showing the male chauvinism, he walks out. He goes back to Kannagi, and who accepts like the Patni we see in all present day movies. And then she says, I will give you my anklet, you sell it. Both of us will go to Madurai and sell this. And they travel to Madurai, where Kovalan goes to a goldsmith's place and he hands over an anklet. And then this goldsmith was the one who stole the king's, rather the queen's anklet. And to obscure that crime, he thinks that if I show this to king, then I'll be safe. So he takes it to the king's men. And that king, the Pandyan, was in some other mood. Actually, Silapadigaram is absolutely cause and effect theory. It's because of Vinay. That's what it says. Many people may not believe it, but that is what it says. That is, Silapadigaram is what you sow, you reap. So what happened is because of something which happened in the previous birth. Now, the king says, behead him, kill him immediately, without even checking what anklet it was. And then, Kovalan is killed, then Kannagi comes to know about that, and he goes to the king's palace, and she shows that her anklet was different. And then the king dies because he was known for justice, and then unable to control her anger, Kannagi burns the entire Madurai. This is in short the story. But Ilangovadigal was a details man. Now during Madhavi's Arangetram, he talks about many things, many aspects of dance, which I think many dancers, at least if you can't read the original, should read the translation. Silapadigaram is of course in a tough Tamil, like Sangam literature, but there are translations, and there are also in simple Tamil there are some explanation, which is the book I have, which was published in 1944, and I'll come to that in a bit. Now he explains about the qualities of a dancer, the qualities of the musician, the qualities of the person who composes for dance, the qualities of the person who plays the flute, qualities of the person who plays the yaar, the mridangam, and so on and so forth. Right? This is one chapter, this Arangetra Kadai. But what is of particular interest, especially to this session, is the Aichir Kuravai section, where Kannagi is handed over to the Aichir lady, Madhuri, if I'm not wrong. And what is important is what happens there. And she's a Vaishnava. Being a Yadav, she is a devotee of Krishna. So Ilangovadigal, despite being a Jain, didn't have any qualms about writing verses in praise of Lord Vishnu. And this one, that segment, there are about four or five verses in that segment only, whatever a Mattaki, which was attuned by M.S. Subbalakshmi, and that is a very famous Raga Malika. Many people have heard that. That is what is Silapadigaram. Now here, he mentions about how these puns originated, the ragas. And this is what is very, very important to us. What she does is, she asks her daughter and other girls to stand in a circle. Now, Tamil music had four different palais, that is four different ways of bringing out the ragas. One was Ayapale, Chadrapale, Trikonapale, and then Vattapale. Vattapale is the one which we have information about. Not much information is available on other palais, and I don't know how many puns were discovered or invented from that. Now, they are standing in a circle, and the circle is divided into 12 different segments. Why 12 different segments? And there are seven girls. Seven girls denote seven notes, fine. 12 denotes the 12 notes, because you have for each, except for sa and pa, you have two variants. But more than that, what Silapadigaram, what Ilangovadigal has mentioned, and also what Adiyarku Nallar in his commentary has mentioned, it is astrology, Indian astrology, where you have 12 different houses. Of course, even Western astrology has 12 different houses. And why only seven? Seven planets. What about the rest? What about the other two? As per Indian astrology, Rahu and Ketu are Chaya Grahas. They don't have any form. So these seven, they depict the nodes, and they also depict the planets, which goes to show that probably we are controlled by planets and we are controlled by music as well. That is probably one of the interpretations. Now, I'm making it short to just explain to you how these ragas emanated. This is the basis for everything. And Silapadigaram, unlike what is popularly believed, was not composed in 5th century or 7th century or whatever. It was composed during 2nd century. I have enough proof for that, because I have the original text, which commentary by Adiyarku Nallar, and which is compiled by son of Uveswaminathaiyar, who is called as Tamil Tata. And there, Silapadigaram talks about, at the end of it, it talks about building a temple, Cheran Chengutuvan, even though Vedigal's brother, building a temple for Kannagi, once everything gets over, as Karpu Devan. Okay, that's a different issue. But it says that somebody by name Aya Babu from Ceylon, the present day Sri Lanka, attended the ceremony. And if one looks at history, there was somebody by name Aya Babu who ruled Ceylon during the 2nd century and during the 10th century as well. Definitely Silapadigaram was not composed in 10th century. So it was composed during the Kadai Changa Kalam itself, when the Sangam thing was happening. Silapadigaram was composed. Right. Okay. So the Sangam music of Sangam also is closely related to that. So what he says, this is of course interpretation. He just, Ilangovadigal just wrote two lines. And this is the interpretation of this Arumpada Urayasiriyar, much, much earlier to, those days there were Urayasiriyars who wrote commentaries on poems. And then Adiyarku Nallar was a 15th century gentleman, and he interpreted. And what he says, listen to this carefully. Kural kuralayadu sembalai. Kural, sa, that is sembalai. And sembalai is the basis for all these ragas. Sembalai is our, rather, the present day Harikambodhi. Unlike other forms, it very clearly shows that Harikambodhi was the basis. Then, Tuttam Kuralayadu Padumalai Palai. Tuttam is Re. Now, talking about Grihavedam, what is now known as Grihavedam, existed in Tamil land 2500 years ago. And that is the basis for all ragas. It is only, that is one raga coming from other ragas. Janya ragas were different, but this is using Grihavedam. I know I'm slightly technical. People who are not that familiar with music, classical music, might find it difficult, but simple. You have Sari, Gama, Pada, Ni. And if one of the swaras is made as the base sa, it becomes another raga. That is the basis. Now, Tuttam Kuralayadu Padumalai Palai. If we now take the present day Carnatic music, say theory, if the Re of Harikambodhi, the Rishabham Harikambodhi is made as the base, it becomes Natabhairavi. So Padumalai Palai is Natabhairavi. If you remember that Kurundove mentions about Padumalai Palai, that is thunder sounding like, say, Padumalai Palai. Then Kaikalai Kuralayadu Sevvali Palai. I am leaving this for the present moment. I am coming back to that in a minute. Ulai Kuralayadu Arumpalai, that is Ma, becomes Sa, which is Arumpale, which is the present day Shankarabharna. Idi Kuralayadu Kodipale, which is the present day Karaharapriya. Bilari Kuralayadu Bilari Pale Todi. This is absolutely as per Carnatic music theory. Harikambodhi, if you take Re as the base, it becomes Natabhairavi. Ga, forget it for a moment. Ma is Shankaravarnam. Pa is Karagara Priya. Then Da is Shankaravarnam. I think I left. Pa is Shankaravarnam. Ma is Ma is Shankaravarnam, sorry. And Pa is Karagara Priya. And then Da is Todi. And Ni is Kalyani. That is Mercham Pale. Why did I leave out Sarpadi Pale? Now, as per this theory, if you note, when this Ga of Harikambodhi is made as the base, it doesn't give a valid raga. What do you mean by a valid raga? In Carnatic music, two madhyamams, two maas are generally not allowed. It's from the Hindustani system, which is allowed. So, here, if you take Ga of Harikambodhi as the base, it gives a raga, which is Sa, then in the present day parlance, it is Sutta Rishabham, then you have this Sadhana Gandharam, then you have the Sutta Madhyamam, Prati Madhyamam also, then the Sutta Devatam, and then Kaisiki Nishadam, which is not a valid raga. So, Carnatic music doesn't allow this, but Tamil music allowed it, and it is called a Sarpadi Pali. And this is equal to, not in this structure, but the swaras are equal to a rag called Lalit in the present day Hindustani system. Sometime back, I also read in the papers, there was somebody who was doing research, and there he mentioned that Lalit was used in Tamil music, and I was wondering how. So now I got to know sometime ago, it was a kind of serendipitous discovery for me. So, Lalit was in you, that Sarpadi Pale, as I think one of the verses also I was mentioning about Sarpadi Pale, and there was also Nadal Nilam is Sarpadi. So, more than 3,000 years ago, all these melodies existed. Goes to show that Tamil music was the precursor, not only for Indian music, even for Western classical. Why I'm saying this? Because there was somebody called Straw, who is a Greek historian. And he lived between 64 BC and 24 AD. And he's on record saying that Greece adapted music from India, though it doesn't say South India, but what music was existing those days. And there is a similarity between these five lands in Tamil, five different regions in Tamil land, and also the five different regions in Greek, which were Dorian, Lydian, Phrygian, Aeolian, Ionian. Five different lands, and these are five different modes in the present day Western classical. And in one of my previous presentation, that was about film music, I also mentioned that Western classical evolved from Greece, and this goes to show that Greek music also was inspired from music from Tamil land, and that became Western classical music. It may be debatable, but I'm willing to debate later, even offline. This is only a, as I said, an objective view. Now, Sela Parigaram, the second segment is over. So, then there was some gap. What that gap was is beyond the scope. There was something called Bhakti movement in Indian, mainly South Indian. And let us hear what Virat sings, and then we will talk about that.
தோடுடைய செவியன் விடையேறி ஓடுவதை சூடி காடுடைய சுடரை பொடி பூசியன் உள்ளம் கவர் கழுவன் ஏடுடைய மலரான் முறை நாட்பணிந்தே தருள் செய்த பீடுடைய பிரமா புறமேவிய பெம்மானிவனன்றோ
So some of you would have recognized this as
Tevaram.
Tevaram was written by three different Nayanmars. Upper also called as Thirunavukkarasar, then Thirunjana Sambandha, and then Sudharamurthy Nayanar. And there was somebody called, it was compiled later. And this was composed by Thirunjana Sambandha. He was a small child, that is what the legend says in Sirdari, and he was crying for milk, and legend says that Parvati came down and fed him milk, and then he started singing. But what is amazing is that this Tevaram uses pun from this Sangam period. I said Palai, pun. Palai is the base, and then the seven Palais, and then pun. Pun is the ragam. That is, you can call it as Janyaragam, but there are also Sampurna ragam. There are so many other definitions. As I mentioned in the beginning, I'm not getting into that music theory. So now, Tevaram, it is said, has used 23 different pun. And they're all, you have equivalent of all the present day Carnatic ragas. If you take, there are totally 103 pun, pungal. And Silapadigaram, as per Adiyark Nallar, there are, as per his commentary, there are 11,991 pungal. So 11,991 ragas, where they have gone, nobody knows. And even Tevaram uses only some pungal. And what is special about Thirunjana Sambandha? Again, say sociologically speaking, I must mention it here. He was always accompanied by somebody called Thirunilakanda Yalpanar. So Yalpanam doesn't pertain to the Yalpanam Jafna we know in Sri Lanka. Yalpanar, that is one who played the Yalpanar, musician. And obviously, Yalpanar belonged to a different caste. But there was no difference. Jnana Sambandha always accompanied, rather this Neelakanda Yalpanar always accompanied Jnana Sambandha wherever he went. And leaving this this music part aside, Jnana Sambandha was a great, great Tamil scholar. If we go, actually in many of the people, I think some of my friends are here who read my post where I quote Thirunjana Sambandha. He's one of my favorite poets in terms of Tamil. Now what happened is he traveled together, and once it seems it so happened that this Yalpanar couldn't match what was being sung by Thirunjana Sambandha. So he became so upset that he even broke the yard. But Jnana Sambandha actually consoled him. He said, "This it's not your mistake. It is something else," and he left it at that. There are so many other stories. But this was this. Some books say that it was composed in Megharaga Kurunji, which is the equivalent of Neelambari, present day Neelambari. That is again surprising because Megharagam is rain, one which brings rain. As for Carnatic music theory, it is Amritavashri which brings rain. Now here it is Neelambari which brings rain. Neelambari puts somebody to sleep. Okay. Now this and. Tevaram mentions this as Yal Muripan, that is, he broke the yard. So that's a very interesting aside which I thought I will share. And apart from this Tevaram, there was also this Vaishnavite work which was called Divya Prabandham. There were 4,000 total, just like three people composed Tevaram. This Divya Prabandham was composed by 12 people called Arvars. And again, there was somebody called Tirupanarvar and Panar, musician. He was a musician and he was a Dalit. But here, he was not allowed inside a temple, inside Srirangam. There is a story. So, why I'm saying is this music and society are related. There is, it's always there. That is why literature, music, society, everything is related. So, this was the status. So what happened during Sangam period where everybody was together, but here something happened which nobody knows whatever, it's all our own interpretation. Something happened and there slowly the sect was being isolated. At the same time, Jnana Sambandha, this Thirunilakanda Yalpanar also was a contemporary, but I'm really not sure how this union happened. So it makes very good reading whatever it is and very good interpretation. So this bhakti period existed, say between 8th and 9th century and 10th century to a certain extent. And unfortunately, even this Pasurangal, that is the Divya Prabandham, were composed in pun. but nobody has that. What happened was that it was performed in temples, especially Srirangam, by somebody, by a clan called Arayas, who danced to the tune, set by the Alvars. But somehow it was lost. There was a person called Nada Muni, who again, it was a serendipitous discovery. He discovered Namalvar's works after about 100 years, and then he went around, he collected all these Pasurangal together, and he started singing. Probably he set it to his own tune. But whatever it is, no Pasuram, there are still some people called Oduvar who still perform Devaram in the pant. But how many pants, nobody is sure. But there are Oduvars. How genuine it is different. But it is there. But Pasurangal, as composed by the Alvars, not existing in the pant format. So this happened in the 8th and 9th century. For some centuries, there was a lull. And why there was a lull? History, I'm not touching that. We jump to 15th century. In 15th century, there was somebody who was again whose works are very, very close to my heart. Existed in a place not very far from Chennai, place known for its divinity, and that place is Thiruvannamalai. And some of you know who I am talking about. Arunagirinathar, who was a thalam expert, and even now people are scratching their head to decipher the thalas used by Arunagirinathar. And Arunagirinathar also used pant, but I am coming to that. This is the fourth segment, this is the last segment. So let us listen to a Thirupugal set in a very different thalam by Arunagirinathar. Then we'll continue. Now Viraj will sing that Thirupugal.
Tadi modi vadadu kattidu kaasu tedi yamal vaalu peruvoru madu bagar vaalve enane urugaru maanidadamagaru kanivare nadarupamanagaga நாகலோக மீரேழு பாரு புரியோனே தீதிலாக வேந்தீர சேவர் கொடியோனே தேவ 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 பெருமாடு
The problem with virtual session is that I'm not able to see people. So I don't know how many people know talas. So I don't know how many people deciphered this talam. This goes like in the present day parlance. Again, I'm saying takitta takitta takka takitta takka dimmi takitta takitta. 21 aksharas. Imagine somebody was born in a small place and who had a very bad young life, and that's again beyond the scope, and composed more than nearly 10,000 of Thirupugal, and he didn't just stop with Thirupugal, and for each Thirupugal he also mentioned the thalam, the sandam, though not takita takita. For this, for example, he mentions I have the original text, I mean from an authentic text, and here he has mentioned this it as tana tana tanana tana 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 tanana tana tana tana. So for each Thirupugal he has mentioned this what is called as sandam, and he didn't stop just with Thirupugal. He also composed a lot. He composed kandar anubhuti, kandar alangaram, then kandar andadi, then different vaguppu, and also something called viruttam, mail viruttam and sev viruttam. Just as a sample, I'll tell you, there also there is this thalam aspect. I'm just going to recite one verse, which is from that mail viruttam, and it goes something like this. Chakra prasandagiri mutta kilindu vilipattu kavcha sailam tagara perunkanaka sigara silambu medu thanidirkum ampuviyum pen
திக்கு தடங்குவடும் ஒக்க குலுங்கவர் சித்திர பதம் பெயரவே சேரன் முடி திண்டாட ஆடல் புரி வெஞ்சுர திடுக்கிட நடிக்கு மயில்
So it goes in khandam. Generally peacock, male is peacock. Peacock is supposed to be soft. But here he compares peacock, he calls peacock as aggressive. It emerges from, and when it comes, all the hills, including Meru and all the seven mountains are broken. The mountains of Asura. And it just goes aggressively. And Adi Sesha is... actually shivering, he is wondering what is happening. Deva Sashing, there is of course next verse also in this connection. I'm not reciting that. So this just a specific example of how Arunagirinadhar composed. Now I was talking about Arunagirinadhar composing setting not only in Thalam but also in Ragam, and he called of course in Pan, 15th century Pan, and surprisingly enough the Tirupugal, it is lost. I don't know how, but one of this Vaguppu, which is Bhuda Vedala Vaguppu, where he describes the fight between Muruga's army and Surapadma's army. Muruga's army has this Bhutam, Bhuta Ganam from Shiva's army. So they are fighting, and these Bhuta Ganadigal are singing in ragas. That is how he say, and in Thalam. So there he mentions about so many ragam. I'll just read out. It says kala marada varahi sigandigai bala sikamara manavi panjigai gauda bhairavi lalitai kaisigai gauli malahari bauli isaivana ganavaradi irumpada manjari tanatanasi vidam pad panjami kaichulavu konmurai viditta raga tadaitil uchchamadi sadaga meduttu mel ettuvana. They are reaching the mel shajjam. And கஞ்ச கஞ்ச நற்றேசி ராஞ்சி குறிஞ்சி பண் குறித்து யாழை ஏந்துவ. ஐ ரெட் அவுட் பேசிக்லி பிகாஸ் ஆஃப் திஸ். நவ் ஹியர் இட் மென்ஷன்ஸ் அபவுட் ராகாஸ் ஆஸ் எக்ஸிஸ்ட், த நேம்ஸ் ஆஃப் ராகாஸ் ஆஸ் தேர் எக்ஸிஸ்டிங் நவ். யூ ஹேவ் வராளி, யூ ஹேவ் மஞ்சரி, மஞ்சரி இஸ் தேர் இன் த பண் ஆல்சோ அண்ட் இட் இஸ் தேர். பட் தேர் ஆர் அதர் திங்ஸ் லைக் பைரவி, தி தமிழ் பண், தமிழ் பண் ஈக்குவலன்ட் ஆஃப் பைரவி இஸ் கௌசிகம். பட் ஹியர் ஹி மென்ஷன்ஸ் த கர்நாடிக் ஈக்குவலன்ட். சோ வாட் ஹேப்பன் தேர் ஒன் ரியலி டசன்ட் நோ. But he is also talking about Kurinji Pan and Yaal, which means that Pan was existing. Probably that was the time when this transition was taking place. That is Pan becoming Ragas or whatever. They merged together. So after Arunagirinadhar, we covered all the four segments. I'm going to conclude now. After Arunagirinadhar, we had 16th century, we had Muthu Tandava, the first of the Tamil Trinity, which was much even before this Carnatic music trinity. And Muthu Tandava's compositions mention Carnatic music ragams only, not pan like how Arunagirinadhar has mentioned. Which means by 16th century, pangal slowly disappeared as they were in Sangam, during Sangam period. So that is the story of the real story of music in Tamil literature. As I said, I can go on and on and on. It has been a really enjoyable session, basically because I worked for it for really 2.5 weeks. Not because I didn't know this, because I wanted to condense it as much as possible. Even now, I've exceeded the limit by about 8 minutes. But that's fine, as long as people like it. So that is about it. This is the history of Tamil music, which, objectively speaking, was the precursor all to all the systems which are classical systems which are existing now.